Hey, horse people. What I do? I moved the cat food on that ledge, and the raccoons haven't gotten it. So the kitties learned where the food's at, and the water bowl. So anyway, gonna go sight in the little 22 here. Oh, that's a gun. Somebody told me you can't show a gun on YouTube, cause you get in trouble. It's against the law. What the hell?
Here.
Ruger 10/22. Come get me. I broke the law.
Well, hopefully that got in the picture there. I noticed I was a little small there. Oh well, if it didn't, that's a Ruger 10/22. So, somebody wanted me to answer a couple questions.
So, I want to answer a couple questions. And if somebody's tuning in, and I'm sitting on here swinging and it makes you sick, alternate F4 will stop the swinging. Hold down the alternate key in F4. I think it's different for apples. So, what are we going to do here? This girl wrote me a question and basically says, "Hi, kitty. I got to clean my shoes." This girl writes me a question and says, Texas coffee. Good. So she says, I've got this horse, and I know you don't answer questions, but I haven't seen a video where you answered a question in a while, so I wonder if you'd answer this. And basically, I think I already answered it and deleted it, so I can't pull it up. But the gist of it is, she's got this horse that wants to, they call it jigging on the trail or getting excited or always in a hurry, kind of like when I show Mr. T wanting to come back home, either to the barn or other places, he gets a little excited and he wants to come back. Some people call that jigging on the trail. So when a horse is in a hurry and getting somewhere, what a lot of people do, let me piss off some women, mostly women and horses that are scared, that get out there and get their horse, and they want a hot horse or a well-bred horse or an Arab horse or some other horse that's going to be naturally a little hot or warm-blooded. You don't see too many people, men or women, riding cold-blooded horses. They're bigger, but they're slower, they're calmer. Those little halflingers are pretty cute horses if you're not too big. I couldn't ride a halflinger, but you could. So anyway, when a horse is jigging and he's getting excited, she said he does fine by himself. But when there's other horses, he wants to be in the front. He sidesteps, he hops, he even rears. She says she can hold him back, but she's little and she can't really. She feels like she's fighting him. She is fighting him. So, the people that's been watching me for a while kind of know what I'm going to say here. Hi, kitty. Oh, scratch my belly, Dad. You need to let a horse know, a horse that always wants to run and that you're always holding them back, knows that if I try to run, it'll make you nervous and you'll hold me back. So when a horse tries to run and you're always trying to hold back, who's controlling that event? Horses. The horses, watch me make the stupid human pull back on the reins and get nervous and squeeze her legs and go into a fetal position. Go, oh, don't run. Oh, I won't be able to stop you. If you're on a horse, that's something else she said. I'm afraid to let him run because I don't think I'll be able to stop him. Are you kidding? You're going to get on a horse that you can't stop? Well, in her mind, I can hold it back, so if I don't let it run, I don't have to worry about stopping it. Man, that's crazy. That's like saying, if I don't press on the accelerator, I'm in a car, it's in drive, and I'm downhill. But if I don't press on the accelerator, and it has no brakes, it's okay. Because I just won't press on the accelerator. If you're on a horse that you don't think you can stop, you're scared, you're insecure, you don't know what you're doing, you don't have good rein control. The horse knows all that, and you are setting you and your horse up to fail because you're not showing the horse that, hey, I can control you, I can stop you. Now the cat's going to go over and mess with the, if the thing shakes, the cat's decided to rub himself on the tripod. Oh, a little buggy. Where these little gnats came from. I'm due for my monthly shower. So anyway, when you're on a horse, what that girl needs to do and what everybody should do is get in a round pen, get in a small square area, get in any type of pen that the horse can't run off, and you get on there with one rein and you learn how to control that horse with one rein. And until you do that, you're not going to learn individual. I get people on a horse, I tell them use one rein. And they'll use one rein when I tell them, and they'll do it a few times. But as soon as the fear kicks in, as soon as something happens that they're not familiar with, they go to two, fetal position, close up, tighten all the muscles. This is a normal, natural instinct for humans to go like this. If we're scared, we're gonna crouch, maybe so we can jump, kick, fight, run. Fight or flight kicks in. Humans just go into this comfort or fear mode. I guarantee you when the bomb went off, oh man, the kitty's really going high after a bird.
Let me get this.
Oh darn it, he saw me.
Are you gonna get you a little birdie? He got a bird the other day, I wasn't happy about it. All right, so that's Kitty and Bird Watch. The boys are in the back over there. I know, the idiot cameras for the stupid human telling me I'm spinning too fast. I think that's kind of centered.
So, this girl wants me to answer her question. You're a dummy for riding a horse that you're afraid that you can't stop if he runs. Because when he runs, and he will run, okay, newsflash. All right, people, here's that big secret I've been holding back. Horses run. Oh my God, Rick, really? I thought my horse would just trot and walk. I didn't know he'd run. Horses run. They kick, they bite, they buck, they rear. They're horses. So this girl is really in a false sense of security because she's out there riding a horse that, one, she always tries to hold that horse back, creating frustration, pain. I guarantee you she's got a bit in that horse's mouth. That horse is always on the bit pulling. She's always pulling back. His face is getting numb. His numb's getting numb. She's probably doing nerve damage. This horse is dancing. He doesn't like it. He doesn't enjoy it. His anxiety goes up because he's always getting pulled on, and he's always dancing, and she's always pulling. He's like, ow, it hurts. I want to run. Oh, ow, you're not leaving me. You don't have trust in me. You don't think you can stop me. I never get to run because you're scared that you can't stop. And the horse just builds up and builds up and builds up. Gee, I can't imagine why that horse is nervous and doesn't listen to her. Anybody else? I was going to say somebody write me the answer on why that horse is nervous, but I'll have too many people taking that literally. So, you need to, I don't know if you could read that. This isn't a logo and this ain't an endorsement of this coffee cup. I just pulled it out of the cupboard. So, how does she fix this? One, she rides, well, wait a minute, let's discuss why the horse does this. And this is a common question that deals with a whole bunch of questions that may be different. Why does a horse do that? All right, you had a chance to think, get the brain working. Bunches of reasons why the horse does that. Hopefully you said he's a herd animal, he's competitive. He feels comfort when he's with other horses. He doesn't like to be the last horse because in the herd world, the last horse is the one that gets eaten if something, a predator comes in behind him. When horses travel in a line, or if they're going to get a drink or they're in a herd, a lot of times the stallion will follow the herd to protect him from the rear, and the mare will lead him, or he'll direct the mare from the rear and push her. Mares don't run the herd. Go on with that nonsense. So the last horse, or if a horse is in a pack, the one on the outside gets eaten. So Why do horses always want to be trying to get in to the higher horse when they're grazing in the middle? Because the middle's a safe point. If this is Cuffy Cup's high horse, all the horses around are lower. The horses farther out are lower than these horses, because if they weren't, they would move in and push them out. So when a horse gets jiggy on a trail because of he's nervous, or he's got herd issues because he's kept alone, because he never gets to be with the horses, and he's like, holy cow, I finally get a chance to be the horse. A lot of people that keep their horses in stalls and not on a herd have herd, what's called herd sour. I don't like that word. They just want to, their drive to be with other horses is more. Or it can have the opposite effect. They're so used to being in their little stall to where they can kick and bite and nobody ever gets to touch them, they get aggressive when other horses are around. Stalls create bad things no matter what you do. And I, you know, had some other lady writing me about in Antarctica, we have to blanket our horses or they'll die, or Ireland where it rains, or Seattle, somewhere. It rains so much here that our horses get rain rot if we don't put a cover on them or something. Well, look, I'm not everywhere in the world. I don't know every climate and every weather condition. I kind of know what I've dealt with and what I've kind of read or seen, but I don't have firsthand knowledge of living in Alaska, and I don't have firsthand knowledge of living down in Florida where the swamps or alligators are after people. I mean, I haven't been anywhere, so I don't know all the answers. What I'm giving you things is from my perspective. It's relative to me and my experiences. Hi, boys! Boys are coming in.
See how these horses are walking in? Buddy's in front. Mr. T's in the rear. Oh, see, Rick? See, Rick? Buddy's in charge. You're a dummy. Buddy ain't in charge. Mr. T's in charge. Just because he's in the back don't mean that he's not in charge. That's how that stupid rumor, mares run the herd, they're always in the front. That's idiot talk. So, Mr. T's like, idiots? Are you talking about humans, Dad? Hi, Mr. T. Buddy, got 10 acres to eat, and he comes over here to stick through the barbed wire so he can cut his face and eat one stinking weed. You're killing me, dude. You're killing me. They already had their breakfast. They heard me talking. Probably thought they were going to get a second helping. So why? I'll let y'all look at horses instead of me. So why does this lady write me and explain all this? Because she's scared and she doesn't know. And when fear takes over, it does a lot of things, not only between you and your horse, but it does things about common sense and reason. When people are scared, they'll go to anybody if they think that person can make them feel safe. It was pretty funny. You guys may not catch up on the news. There's a couple of women here that, well, this ain't funny that they were kidnapped. But there's two or three women. I don't know the exact story. Oh, they're going to groom each other. I'm like, good boys, if Dad'll shut up. So, uh-oh. Buddy said I'm leaving. So there's a couple of women that were abducted and kept locked up by these three brothers. And one of them escaped. And the guy that found them, one of the neighbors, was a black guy. And that's relevant. I'm not saying that because it's, oh, now Rick's racist. Whatever. Idiots. He's a black guy, and that's going to be relevant in a minute. So he goes to the house, and the girl's evidently trying to get out of the door. The door's locked. She's sticking her arm out. So he ends up kicking in the door like a responsible person should be. You got a woman in there yelling, help, 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 and she can't get out. He helped her. So he did the right thing. Good for him. So when he's being interviewed later, the news person asked the guy, so what was your first clue? When did you think something was wrong? He goes, look, when a young, good-looking or young, little white woman comes running to the arms of a black man, he goes, something's wrong. I thought that was funny. Yeah, I know, I must be a racist or something for thinking that, but that's pretty funny. So anyway, hi, buddy. All right, you see all that hay on the ground in there? When I throw them a flake of hay, they pick through it and they eat what they want. And they have choices. So they have all this green grass out here, so they're eating this hay and they're leaving this. So what I do with that excess is I sweep it out to where there's a little bit of mud right there, and I just let them pound that in. That way, when it rains, it's going to create a better foundation right there that they can stomp it in, kind of like making bricks, and they'll stomp that straw and hay into the mud, and that'll make it a little bit less muddy there. So that's what I do with the excess hay. That's, somebody's going to obviously tell me that I shouldn't do that, but whatever. So back to this question. I don't even know what time it is here. All right, I think I'm on 15 minutes. My coffee's almost empty anyway. That's my timer. When I'm done with my coffee, I end the video. So what this girl needs to do, come on people, you know what she needs to do. She needs to get her butt out there and get in a round pen, get in a small area, ride that horse with one rein, learn rein control. Rein control is not about the horse, it's not about the bit, it's not about the rope halter. It's about, someone else wrote me a question about a bit, a snaffle bit is soft and kind. And I lit into her on Facebook, and then I had 14 other women write me and tell me I hate women because I called her a freaking idiot. She writes that the bit is kind and soft. Look, it's freaking metal, you big dummy. It ain't soft, and it ain't kind or mean. No different than a car is kind or mean when it runs your ass over. It's a car, and a bit is a bit, and it's designed for pain and pressure. And it's designed to make the horse do pain compliance. It's just like when a police officer uses a twist lock or an arm bar to get you to comply. And I used to teach this, so I know it's called pain compliance techniques. Impact weapons. When I hit you with a baton, the baton isn't soft. It's called pain compliance. When I hit you with the baton, it hurts. Then you start listening to me. That's what batons are. So all you idiots that think bits are soft and kind, okay, next time you see a police video where a cop's beating a dude with a stick, you remember that batons are soft and kind. And when I twist your arm and I get your nerves and your joints and pain, I'm kind. You idiots. Anyway, this girl needs to get out there and ride with one rein and sit on that horse. What is that going to do is multitude of things. People think, oh, well, I'll just get on there and work on my reins. You're not just working on your reins. You're working on the horse giving the pressure. You're working on your timing. You're working on having a better seat. You're working on your confidence. You're working on not falling forward or leaning back, staying centered in the saddle. You're learning how to turn a horse and how to respond smoothly. You're gaining confidence, and as your confidence builds, your fear goes away. Fear is a lack of confidence, a lack of knowing what's going to happen, a fear of the unknown or a fear of what you think might happen. That's where your fear comes from. If you're confident and you know what's going to happen and you know you can handle it, your fear will go away. This girl's telling me she's scared because if the horse runs away, I don't think I can stop it. Well, that's dumb on so many levels. One, you shouldn't be on it. Two, you shouldn't get on a horse that scares you. Three, if you don't have that much confidence in yourself, you shouldn't be riding a horse out in the open area where it can run off. Because sooner or later, the horse is going to run off. She thinks she can stop that horse using a bit. She thinks she's strong enough to stop it. And her theory is, if I don't let it get in a run, it won't run. Well, I got news for her. When that horse spooks or something scares that horse, she ain't going to be fast enough or strong enough to stop that horse from running. My horses run when they get spooked. I went out riding the other day, and I come through this area, and I was riding Buddy and had a... Hi, kitty. Little kitty came to me. If you can see him. I know. What are you doing? You're over here messing up the program. Daddy was trying to tell a story. So I'm riding Buddy past this old barn, and I've got Mr. T tied to the saddle or looped to the saddle, so I'm ponying Mr. T. This big ass 14 wingspan, 14 foot, I mean, this is a huge, I think they call them turkey vultures, comes flying out of this shed because he was in that roosting, and we scared it because we walked by because we were off the trail in the middle of nowhere, and we said, okay, let's go by this old building, that's pretty cool, and as we go by there, it spooked him. So he comes barreling out. Well, when a bird comes out with a huge wingspan the size of a door, guess what? Not only did it scare the crap out of me, Buddy says, dude, hang on, I'll save you. He took off like a bat out of hell. Mr. T's like, what the hell? Mr. T's pulling on one way, so he's pulling Buddy off with the saddle because he's tethered to the horn. I'm trying to slow Buddy down, figuring out what the hell just happened because it all happened in a matter of 2 seconds. I had to make sure because I ponied enough, I couldn't turn Buddy away from Mr. T because that would cause Mr. T to go the other way and it would pull us both to the ground, knock us over. So I had to make sure I pulled Buddy into Mr. T and spin him into Mr. T so we could turn around, stop his running, and see what the hell just attacked us from his building. Well, it worked out okay. 5-10 feet later, pucker factor kicked in, and I got them both stopped, and I watched that bird do a circle, kind of like, dude, why are you by my house? And I'm like, man, that's a great. So, guess what? When I left that area, I had to go by that house again. Gee whiz, Rick, why would you go by there every scare? Because I'm going to go by there every day, because I want that bird to come out every day, because now I'm ready. Now I know I've already handled it once when I didn't know it was there. I know I'm going to handle it better when he's there, and I want my horse to figure out the bird might come out of there. There's a place down the road here where these horses stay in these stalls, and they're in the dark until a horse comes by, and then they come shooting out to the fence. Well, they scared the crap out of me and Buddy about, oh, I don't know, 3 or 4 times. You know what? I've been by there every time I go ride, and guess what? Those horses come barreling out, and Buddy just kind of looks over and goes, I knew you were there. That ain't nothing. Because he learned. That's what this horse needs to do with this girl. He needs to learn that it's okay to run, that she's not going to panic and brace my head and pull on both reins and go in her fetal position. She's going to allow me to run. She's going to ride my run. She's going to go ahead and give me some direction while I'm running. She's not going to try and stop me. Guess what? I'm going to get tired of running. I'm not going to think running is such a cool thing anymore. I'm going to... Kitty, watch. He's on the prowl. Doo-doo, doo-doo, doo-doo. Oh, got a bug. Get that ladybug. So that's what she needs to do. She needs to learn herself. Guess what? I can handle it. Guess what? I can do it. Guess what? It ain't no big deal if he runs. Guess what? If he does run, I know how to reach down with one hand and use one rein because I've ridden with one rein. And when a horse spooks or panics, I have to be able to have that mindset and that reaction and that learned muscle memory that when I get in a crisis with a horse, I never sit back, curl up, and pull on both reins. That's a natural instinctive move. You need to train your body that a different move, which is a learned move, that I reach down with one rein and slowly pick up the rein and turn the horse's head a little bit. Because when I do that enough, the horse starts learning whenever I reach down with one rein, my head's going to go. So he will start anticipating and he will turn his head. And when he does that, the horse is going to learn to stop. You're going to feel more control. You're going to have more confidence. You're going to not panic and try to stop him from running all the time. And then you're going to be able to control him without fighting with him. Because there's a difference between controlling a horse and fighting a horse. Just like there's a difference between communication with a horse and nagging a horse. And I did that video on nagging, and I got all kind of hate mail from some people because I was picking on a woman. And then I got other people that are like, oh my God, this is the greatest video ever. It's perfect. That's what I do. Thanks for telling me. Which is how I usually get most videos. I got two sides. My videos are a curse and a gift. And they're a curse to the woman with the chip on her shoulder that want to personalize it and be, oh, he picking on me because I'm a woman, he don't like women, and poor me, and I'm gonna call Obama and see if I can't get a free woman phone, whatever. And then the other side where it's a gift is I got women out there with a brain who are self-sufficient. It's like, you know what, I need to learn. This makes sense, and when I do it and I practice it, it works. Therefore, it improves my relationship with my horse. Good job. So you can look at things and see what you want. You can look in a mirror and see a mean barn witch, or you can look in a mirror and see a decent person who's trying to do the right thing and trying to learn and grow. It's up to you on what you see. I can't control that. I can only put out the information. Okay? So we'll end that there on answering that question about being scared, fear, letting a horse run off. Stop trying to stop your horse from running off. Big problem, and a lot of people riding. The more you try and stop, the more you're going to increase that anxiety, the more you're going to create pain, the more you're going to tell the horse you don't know what you're doing, the more the horse is going to learn when I do run, you get nervous and you either get off, stop, turn me around, take me back to barn. I make you uncomfortable. When I make you uncomfortable, you're a poor leader. I don't want to trust you. I'm not going to trust a poor leader when they can't control me. Therefore, you're not in control. I'm in control, so I'll just let you sit up there until trip to the hospital. Hi, what happened to you? My stupid horse hurt me. Ain't no stupid horses, only stupid humans. Well, in that there, buddy, Mr. T, you're good boys. Dude, we're taking a nap. Leave us alone. Go fill up your coffee.